friends. I think that most of the comrades and friends sitting here, they know something about what is called this economics and some. So that is sufficient. So whatever I say, I think that it may be communicated freely. And if some points are to be explained, then we will do it later. That you can decide. Number two, if an explanation in Tamil is needed, then some comrades can intervene or some friends can intervene and a brief statement or a sum up of what I have already stated can be given. That we will do according to your requirements. You can intervene. Actually, the basis, the introduction to what I am going to say here is already made by Comrade Shelby, Comrade Manoharan, Comrade Murugan. So these comrades have already made this what I have already, I am going to say. The idea is very simple. It is very simple that today we are in a situation where our economy, our economic condition is now transforming itself as a foundation for fascism. Because if you examine history, world history, in Europe, in Italy, in Germany, when Mussolini and Hitler came to power, these countries experienced, as you know, unprecedented economic crisis. For example, there is a saying in a beautiful saying that in Germany in the 20s, before Hitler came to power, the extent of the economic crisis was explained by economists and historians in a beautiful way. That people went to the market with a basket full of notes and returned with a pocket full of goods. You can understand. That means they went to the market with notes, currencies in basket, and returned with the goods in the pocket. That means that much the money itself become worthless, of no use, that much the extent of crisis. So in a similar way, even though it is not in that form, in India today we are experiencing certain symptoms and certain in our life it is we are experiencing. And this experience of most of the friends who talk here already, they have explained, they have pointed out. So in our country, not only critics, not only political opponents, even those who are on the side of the ruling class, even official economies, they themselves are saying that our country today is facing the present crisis, the present economic condition in our country is the severest in 70 years. That is the statement. 70 years, 7 decades. Such a crisis has never been there in our country after the transfer of power in 1947. That is the extent. Therefore, that prompted, that made, compelled the finance minister, Mrs. Sitharaman, Nirmala Sitharaman, to announce a mid-term budget immediately after the presentation of a full maiden budget. Nirmala Sitharaman presented her maiden budget in July 5, 2019. So last week, that means within 2 months, she was supposed to make another announcement, which is now in paper. You have seen that this is just like a mini budget. So this is a very serious situation as far as a country is concerned. So the seriousness is that economy, the productive sphere is collapsing. Production is collapsing. We know that we are sustaining, we are living, we are surviving because production is there, agriculture, industry. So there should be some production and there should be employment to the people also, because otherwise people cannot live. So in the country today, unemployment is the highest in 45 to 50 years. That means 5 decades, this much unemployment was never in our country. So that much seriousness is there. But they are actually diverting the attention of the people to other issues. This is not the core issue, and they are diverting to other issues. For example, until the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank, and you might have heard about certain audit firms, consulting agencies, international consulting agencies like Moody's. You might have heard Moody's, Standard & Poor, etc. You might have heard. So such agencies, International Monetary Fund and World Bank, came to the scene and said that India is facing a serious crisis, you have to intervene. It is only after that, it is only after International Monetary Fund and World Bank, that is the Bretton Woods system, the twin organizations which are there under the control of US imperialism, because America is having veto power in World Bank and IMF, you know, only America alone is having veto power, because this World Bank and IMF are controlling the economy of the whole Afro-Asian Latin American countries, because their experts, their advice, their instructions are now transforming into policies. Our policies are actually instructions, directions given by IMF and World Bank. IMF pensioners, World Bank returned economists are posted as chief economic advisor or planning commission deputy chairman, vice chairman or reserve bank governor coming and going. So all these are experts from Chicago School, Harvard School or IMF or World Bank, we know even now. So their advice and their statement are very important. That is why when IMF and World Bank came to the scene and said that India is in a serious situation, then only Sitharaman, Mrs. Sitharaman came to the scene and announced certain steps. And before going to that, what are these steps? You know, as the speakers here might have already mentioned that. These announcements are very, very simple. One is that they have liberalized these, but there are certain taxes were there on foreign institutional investors. What is foreign institutional investors means it is speculative capital. Capital that is directly entering into speculation in stock market and this financial market. That is what is called institutional investment. So such taxes on such institutional investors are taken away. Then tax laws against or disciplinary action against tax evaders are taken away. Then you know, corporates, monopolies have certain responsibilities as per existing law. These responsibilities are known as corporate social responsibility. So those who are violating these corporate social responsibility, no criminal cases can be charged against them. Such cases should be treated as a civil law. That is the announcement. So economic violation, economic offense shall not be treated as criminal case. It shall be treated as civil case. Then defaulters, bank defaulters are there. Who are the bank defaulters? You know, no, I am saying. Okay, say the bank defaulters are actually not Vijay Mallya and Nirav Modi are small fries. They are Ambanis, Adanis, SR. They are the biggest defaulters. Because I am saying this in a forum, so I should be responsible. So the biggest fraudster, the biggest defaulter is Ambani. His default is the non-performing asset of Adani is 1,25,000 crores. 1,25,000 crores. Mallya's is only 9,000 crores. Similarly, Adani, second in, that is almost more than 1 lakh crores. Then SR, you might have heard about SR. SR company, London based. That is the third place. So in that order, the biggest 10 corporate companies are holding more than 90% of the non-performing assets in banks. That is almost 15 lakh crores of rupees are now in the category of non-performing assets. That means loans which are taken by corporates but not repaid. It is then put in another account where it will not be available. So such loans are known as non-performing assets. So Ambani, Adani, SR are the biggest defaulters. Mallya and others are small fries. The biggest fries are here, but their names will not be officially disclosed by either the banks or the government or the authorities. That is the situation. So these assets. So you see, for example, I can explain that once more. Almost 77 lakh crores are given as loans by banks in 2018. Almost 77 lakh crores as loans Indian banks have given. Almost 77 lakh crores in 2018. This is 2019. Of that, agricultural sector got only 13 to 14 lakhs. Where 50% of the population of India depends. 50%, half of the Indian population is depending on agriculture for their survival. Half of the Indian population. For that sector, only 13% of this entire loan was diverted. The other loan, but the remaining was went to corporate sectors. So this is Indian situation. So what I am saying is, Nirmala Sitharaman's one suggestion was that these defaulters, bank defaulters, the bank officials shall not take action against them. That is another statement. Another statement was 70,000 crores of rupees will be given to banks who are suffering because of non-performing assets so that they can give another 5 lakh crores to They can give another 5 lakh crores to corporates. So I am not going into those details. The point is this. She herself said that they are for unleashing the animal spirits of corporate capital. The animal spirit means going as they like. So their animal spirit. So unleashing the animal spirit of corporate capital is the policy, the line, the main orientation of this government. So the last budget was in accordance with that. Today, I think that you can understand. Today, when a crisis is there, when a serious crisis is there, what is the nature of the crisis? What is the nature of the crisis? Indian people is unable to purchase a Parle biscuit. That is the crisis. You might have heard. 5 rupees, a Parle business, a biscuit packet of Parle is only 5 rupees. So the Indian people, the ordinary people in our country, is unable to purchase a Parle biscuit. That is a crisis. That is also coming. But nothing is done there. And wage rate, the earnings of people are going down. Their bottom level. Nothing is done. Peasants are committing suicide. Nothing is done. So this is the essence. The economy, the productive sphere, employment, everything is collapsing. Nothing is done in that sphere. In the name of crisis, what our government, what the Modi government has done is announcing more facilities, more measures for the plunder of corporate capital. So this is what is going on. This is the point. Now you see what has happened in 2008. You might have heard about a world situation which Comrade Manoharan also pointed out. In 2008, the world experienced a big crisis, which is known as global meltdown. global economic crisis, world economic crisis. You might have heard about the Lehman, breakdown of Lehman company in USA. So in Europe it was known as sovereign debt crisis. The crisis was in China, crisis was in Japan. So from America to Europe to China, so all capitalist imperialist countries experienced this crisis. 2008 crisis. And that crisis was due to speculation. Speculation means, today, corporate, as Comrade Shelby also said, these corporate companies are entering into the sphere of speculation. They are not entering into the sphere of production. Because productive sphere, profit rate is less. But in the speculative sphere, it is money spinning. Money spinning. They can get immense profit by ballooning. It is called the ballooning, the bubble economy. Bubble economy. It is known as in economics, it is known as the bubble economy. Bubbling, ballooning. So the bubbling the economy or ballooning the economy. So that is what is going on. So in economics, these are phrases now used by people. So what is going on is a ballooning. All over the world, a ballooning is going on. That means now, unlike when capitalism was productive, because capitalism is also productive in the sense that it is increasing production. Industrial capitalism, we know that it was in 19th century when capital using technology, application of technology to production, increasing productivity. A small percentage of that increased productivity will be given to workers in the form of wages. So that is the usual capitalism, industrial capitalism. So after some time we know what happened. These capitalists, they abandoning the productive sphere, entered the speculative sphere. Speculative sphere, stock market, other financial markets, then money market, real estate, similar other speculative spheres. These hoarding, black marketing, so many, hundreds of thousands, there are so many areas where we don't know. Because in the stock market itself, I am not going with the details, some people here, they know very well. They know very well than me that there are futures, options. So I am not going into those technical questions. So in the stock market itself, there are speculations. Money is fast entering into that sphere. Money is moving from productive sphere to the speculative sphere. This is imperialism. Imperialism is this. Imperialism means capitalism is abandoning its productive, that approach, that productive, that concentration in production, abandoning that sphere. Imperialism or capital is entering into the productive, speculative sphere. That is finance capital. That is imperialism. So today, I am not going into those details. I am not quoting Marxist economies. There are bourgeois economies, capitalist economies. For example, there is an economist whose name is Peter Drucker. Peter Drucker. You can see Peter Drucker. He has wrote a book, New Realities. Name of the book is New Realities. He said, he is not a Marxist. He said, 90% of the economic activities today have nothing to do with the production. That is what he said. 90% of the economic activities today have nothing, or put it differently, the financial transactions that are going on today, 90% of it has nothing to do with the production. That means it has a speculative function. It is purely speculative. So that is the problem of the crisis today. So the essence is that in India, I have pointed out 2008 crisis. 2008 crisis was because in America, big companies, big corporate companies and banks in Europe, pan-European big financial oligarchs, big financial corporations in China, big finance, then state-sponsored companies in Japan. So they entered into speculative business. There, what has happened? After some time, what has happened? Everything is depending on production. Those capitalists, those financiers, those speculators who are in the speculative sphere, they have to suck out from the productive sphere. So production is creating value. New wealth is always created by production. Value is created always by the proletariat workers. They are creating value. Workers are creating real wealth. So the speculators, what they are doing? Remaining at the sphere of speculation, using several channels, methods, they will suck out from the sphere of production. But there is a limit. What is the limit? If the system is going, I am very simply explaining, this is what is Marxist economics today. When the system is proceeding like this, the purchasing power, consuming capacity, buying power, the real earnings of the common people will go down. Then you cannot sell automobiles. The automobile market will collapse. Even middle class people will not be able to purchase. You cannot sell flats. 5 lakh flats are remaining unsold. 5 lakh flats. 5 lakh flats, big flats, are remaining unsold. As far as common people are concerned, they cannot even purchase Parle biscuits to their children. So this is the point. Then what happens? This you can take surplus value. You can take surplus, or you can appropriate this from the people only through these transactions, selling. It is not possible. Land sale is not possible. Commodity sale is not possible. And even the stock market itself collapsed within 2 months. This is very important. That is the unprecedented nature. Within 2 months of Modi's second coming, you can examine, you can ask your friends. Within 2 months of Modi's coming, from the Indian stock market, 15 lakh crores were evaporated, collapsed. The Indian stock market collapsed, the bubble is broken, burst, and 15 lakh crores have been lost within 2 months. This is the crisis. So the because when you blow up the balloon, after some time what happened, it will burst. So the balloon has burst, that is the problem. So what happened in 2008? In 2008, when the world economy was collapsing, what America did, you might have heard. America did, you know, when I explain, you will know. American Federal Reserve System, name of American Central Bank is known as Federal Reserve System. Federal Reserve, led by Federal Reserve, American government at that time, pumped, channeled $4 trillion into the coffers of these companies which are responsible for collapsing, which are responsible for the crisis, because the speculation is creating crisis. So those companies and corporations, corporate companies, who are responsible, who are the villain, who are the real culprits of this crisis, to them, $4 trillion were pumped. $4 trillion means 25% of American national income, GDP, gross domestic product. Gross domestic product means in simple terms, the American national income in 1 year. Production resources produced, goods produced, income generated in 1 year is called gross domestic product. That is simple terms, common people's national income of America in 1 year. So American national income in 1 year, it was at that time $16 trillion. $1 trillion is 1 lakh crore. At that time, India's national income was only $1.6 trillion. $1.6 trillion. That means three times the national income of India. Three times the national income of India was given to those companies in America from the federal budget. That means from the budget banks, from people's money. Budget is people's money. Budget is money collected from the people, taxes, even borrowing. That is also borne by people. Our government borrowing from World Bank. Our government borrowing from IMF. It is borne by our people. We have to repay. It is not Narendra Modi or Nirmala Sitharaman who repay the money. It is our children. Our children, our sons and daughters have to repay it in the future. So it is people's money. So this money, $4 trillion channeled into, in America it was channeled. You see, I said that it is three times the national income of India in 2008. India's national income, you know, there is a, what is a, the, there is a, that is, which is that, that state in America, near that Mexico, what is that state, the big state in America?
Texas.
So the income of Texas in 1 year is the same as that of India. America has 52 states, you know. 52 states, I mean, 50 states. Texas, the biggest state in America in terms of GDP. Texas, that one state, that GDP is equal to Indian GDP, even now, composed of 1.3 billion people, that means 130 crores of Indian people, their income, and the income of one American state is the same. So I am saying this because the extent of the funding, money that is channeled into the pockets of these corporates in America, when the crisis was there, that means the crisis was created by corporates. The same corporates are given money for the crisis created by them. Europe also, the same, China also, the same, Japan also, the same policy. So that is the policy under neoliberalism. The policy under neoliberalism means, neoliberal policy means, when a crisis is there, crisis is because of the accumulation. What is accumulation, you know? Accumulate, that means how capital, yes, how resources are amassed, how wealth is appropriated. That is what is called accumulation. So it is the capitalist accumulation that is the crisis. The crisis is arising from, crisis is because of the particular form of capital accumulation under neoliberalism. So that crisis is because of the operations of corporate speculators, financial speculators, not because of peasants, not because of industrialists who are in the industrial field, not because of the people. It is only because of the corporate speculation, financiers, corporate sectors, that means speculators, realtors. They are the people, they are the sections responsible for this crisis. So I am going to the point. So in 2008, this was the case. Nirmala Sitharaman today, that means the Modi government today, did the same thing in another form. That means the corporate sector, the financial sector, the big corporates who have committed the mistake, so they have been given further money. they have been given further money. That is what is taking place. That is the point number one. Now what is the repercussions? What are the repercussions? Say, when Modi came, when Narendra Modi came to power in 2014, India was not that much affected by at that time. From 2008, there was a world crisis. But during that time and even the years following 2008, India was relatively immune. India was not affected by the crisis in that sense. Because crisis may be, but that type of a serious crisis was not in India. Because integration of the Indian economy with international capital, coupled with, along with, there are some restrictions. There is less in the integration was not full, then restrictions of corporates, speculation was also there in the economy. Full-fledged, unfettered, unhindered speculation was not there. Some restrictions were there. So it was at that time that from 2008, when the world economy faced a crisis, when the whole world underwent a biggest crisis, which is known as world global meltdown. So in that situation, India was relatively immune, we said. Because even though Manmohan Singh was the architect of these policies, there were certain restrictions. I can give you an example. The Manmohan government tried their best to implement the GST. But Modi never allowed. BJP was the main opposition party. You can check the facts which I am saying now. Narendra Modi, who was a Gujarat chief minister, he came to Delhi. The main opposition party in parliament was BJP. They were resisting the liberalization, the globalization, the privatization policies of Manmohan government. They were resisting. They effectively resisted. It's all fascists are, the old fascists are like this. So the fascists are coming to power by taking the mantle of populism. Hitler, Mussolini, they came to power by utilizing people's support. They usually take an anti-establishment area position while in opposition. So the BJP took an anti-establishment area position. Anti-establishment area means against the system, against the ruling system, against the policies. Apparently popular steps they will take. And utilizing them, they will come to power. So because of that, the Manmohan government could not implement all the neoliberal policies as suggested by international capital, IMF and World Bank, multinational companies, and neoliberal advisors, experts, etc. They cannot implement. But in 2014, therefore, when Modi came, there was somewhat India was the best performing economy in the world in 2014. I am not saying. This was the saying at that, because we were interested in economic textbooks, therefore we also used to read it. Then we used to see these things. India was one of the, we were having criticism. We were saying that these are sham, these are hollow. But they were saying, who? The ruling classes, the mainstream papers, corporate media, they were saying that India was relatively immune. India was a best performing economy in the world in 2014. But after Modi coming to power, what he did?
പാർട്ടിക്ക് വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് ഓക്കെ മൻമോഹൻ സിംഗ് കോംരേഡ് മനോഹരൻ പോയിന്റ് ഔട്ട് അബാൻഡൻഡ് അബോളിഷ്ഡ് ദ പ്ലാനിംഗ് കമ്മീഷൻ 64 ഇയർ ഓൾഡ് പ്ലാനിംഗ് കമ്മീഷൻ വാസ് അബോളിഷ്ഡ് യു നോ സം റെഗുലേഷൻ സം കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് എ കൺട്രോൾ ഓവർ ദീസ് ഇക്കണോമിക് ആക്ടിവിറ്റീസ് പ്ലാനിംഗ് സംതിങ് വാസ് ദെയർ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് അബോളിഷ്ഡ് ദെൻ All controls over corporate capital are taken away. State was made a facilitator. You know the name facilitator. Facilitator means one who facilitates. One who puts the way clear. Facilitate means you help the corporates. A corporate facilitator. State became a corporate facilitator. And so many liberal policies he brought out. And the most important one, you know, demonetization. Demonetization, some people will say that it was a blunder. It was not a blunder. It was a corporate attack. The biggest corporate attack against the people in world history. Because you know money is like the blood in an economy. So in our body, blood is flowing. In the same manner, economy, money is the blood of the economy. So it is the artery, it is the money is flowing through, it is like blood flowing through our arteries and veins. It is like money is flowing through the economy. So it is through money flow, it is through money circulation that wages are paid, investments are made, sale is done, purchase is done, everything is done through money. What this man did, he on one night, November 8, 2016, he came and announced that everything is stopped. And what is stopped means the blood is sucked out. The blood of the people, that is the common people, the ordinary people, you know, who were queuing in front of the banks. We never saw any corporates. We never saw Ambani, Adani, Mallya or Reddy or anybody in the banks. Common people queue, they remain in the queue and died. And the cash-based economy. What is the cash-based economy? Cash-based economy is the informal sector. What is the informal sector? Unorganized sector. What is the unorganized sector? Construction, trading, other transact, all sectors of the in India. In India, listen me, 95% of the economy, Indian economy, then you will understand the importance. 95% of the Indian economy is unorganized. Only 5% of the economy is in the organized sector. Our Indian economy, which the Modi government claims that if they are making it a 5 trillion economy in 2024, 10 trillion economy, $10 trillion economy in 2034, they are claiming. So in this economy which they are going to tigerize, which they are going to make a big world power, everything is collapsing, everything collapsed, that's another thing. So this 5 trillion, now only 2.6 trillion according to their estimate. So in that economy, 95% is unorganized, informal, where only cash-based transactions are there. No digital transactions, no ATM transactions. Even ATM machines are to be bought from China. Narendra Modi announced Make in India, you know, Make in India. But all the they are taking an anti-China position apparently, but all the machines, this core, hard core, essential for Indian ATM machines are brought from China, even now. So, in spite of making India, there is no ATM machines in rural areas. Compared with other countries, India's ATM density is very low. Only in urban areas, India is a country, you know, vast continental size country, where compared with other, there only ATM density is very low, very low, lowest in the world. So there the informal sector is depending on cash, daily cash. That cash is completely stopped for months. What will happen? The blood flow of the economy is collapsed. So the economic activities came to a standstill. The economic activities came to a standstill. But the speculative sphere, the corporate speculators have no problem with the money. I can give you an example from Tamil Nadu. Best example from Tamil Nadu. You can ask, you can verify whether what I am saying is correct or not. This is the Tamil Nadu case. I am not quoting from other states. In Tamil Nadu, there are 10, at the time of demonetization in November 2016, in Tamil Nadu, there are around 1,000 new generation banks. New generation bank, you know, this what is called a Yes Bank, then what is the new generation, other banks are there. Yes?
Equitas.
New generation bank, so many, this Axis Bank. Axis Bank, Yes Bank, this Greenlays. Such banks are new generation banks. So these new generation banks have only less than around 1,000 branches in Tamil Nadu. While the traditional banks have 10,000 branches in Tamil Nadu. You can ask your friends, some bank officers, some bank employees also may be here. They can examine. I am not saying the exact figure. I am making roundabout figures. Around 1,000, there may be some difference may be there. Around 1,000 new generation branches, bank branches, around 10,000 traditional bank branches. What Narendra Modi did? He already printed 2,000 notes. 2,000 notes were already printed. BJP MPs said that we were knowing that demonetization will be there. Ambanis and Adanis were knowing it. So whoever were required to know, they were knowing it. They were already converted their, what is called their black money, they deposited in, already deposited in bank, for example, in Indian banks. During September, October, 6 lakh crores of rupees came into the Indian banks in an unprecedented manner. So many details are there. So all those who were having black money, they already made it white. So what happened was that when this demonetization period was there, these 2000 rupee notes printed, 14,000 crores were allotted to Tamil Nadu. You can check again. 14,000 crores were allotted to Tamil Nadu during December. That means November 18 to December 18, 1 month period. Around 14,000 crores. Modi is a socialist. Therefore, what he said? 50% to new generation banks, 50% to traditional banks. Socialism. So, new generation banks are only 1,000 branches. Who are depending on new generation banks? Corporates, big corporates. They are using new generation banks. Common people are going to State Bank of India or Canara Bank, such banks, or even cooperative banks. So 90% of the 99% of the people are depending on common traditional banks. There, half of the money. Few corporates use this new generation, they are also half of the money. What will happen? So truck loads of 2000 notes went to the corporate godowns. This money cannot be stored in new generation banks. It directly went to corporate godowns. But common people, They were denied money. So this is an example. So what happened was that the whole informal sector, the whole cash-based, unorganized sector, their blood, like our human body, blood was sucked out by corporates. So this demonetization was a corporate attack on the people. It was one of the biggest corporate attack. That means the corporates were, they sucked out the blood of the economy and they made rich, and the common people were taken from the, from them were taken whatever they could. There is a saying in Bible, whom he hath will be given more, whom he hath not, from him shall be taken even that which he hath. That means from the poor people, it will be taken whatever he hath or she hath, and it will be given to the rich people. So this is what happened. So in that way, that is number one. So demonetization actually collapsed the entire Indian economy. Then the now studies are coming. There is a task force of the economy is there. We must know what is that. Task force of the economy is there. A task force. I think that a man, his name is Arabind Modi. Arabind Modi. Not connected with the Narendra Modi. He's a different man. Arabind Modi. He is led by him, a committee is going on. That committee examined and found that during the demonetization period, 60% reduction in investment was there in the country. 60% reduction in investment means you imagine what will happen? Collapse. So demonetization collapsed the Indian economy. Then came GST. What is GST? Shifting the tax burden to the shoulders of common people. Say, in capitalism, you might have heard about the welfare state. In the 30s, a great crisis was there in the world economy, world imperialist economy, great economic depression. Great economic, the whole world was went under a crisis which is known as great economic depression. That also was because of speculation. Wall Street crash. Some of you might have heard Wall Street crash. American stock market collapsed, the bubble burst because of speculation. So Roosevelt, he came, he discussed with, because at that time there is one world situation was different. The communist movement was advancing. National liberation movements were advancing. Anti-colonial struggles were developing, 30s and 40s. So imperialism, they, instead of resorting to anti-people policies, instead of directly helping the corporates who are responsible for the crisis, imperialism resorted to welfare state, because otherwise communist advancement will be there. Anti-colonial struggles will develop. Working class, communist movement was advancing at that time. Therefore, they invented, you have heard about the Keynes. So led by his theory, they made what is called a welfare state. Throughout the world, world level, a welfare state came into being. What is the essence of the welfare state? It is not their generosity. It is because of the people's struggle. Because of the people's struggle, because of the advancement, the ideological, political advancement of the progressive forces, international left, imperialism was compelled to adopt a mask, a camouflage, a cover, so that they put forward what is called welfare state. And the essence of the welfare state was progressive taxation. Progressive taxation means when income, wealth level goes up, rate of tax will go up. Clear? When the income, wealth goes up, rate of taxation will go up. This is what is called the progressive taxation. So in the world over, progressive taxation was imposed, I mean implemented. Even today you see in Scandinavian countries where welfare state is there, some form of welfare state is there even today. Netherlands, then Ireland, I mean this what is called Finland, Sweden, Switzerland, these areas, they are some form of welfare cities. They are still progressive taxation is there. That means the share of taxation in these countries, imperialist countries, the share of taxation in imperialist countries, these are very simple things you can understand. The share of taxes in imperialist countries is like this. That is 60% direct tax, 40% indirect tax. Indirect tax means tax on the common people. Indirect tax means it is not direct. It is tax on commodities, tax on consumption, tax on services, which common people cannot be taxed on income or wealth because they have no income, they have no wealth. So they can be taxed only from consumption. Clear? Common people, majority of the people are poor. So such people can be taxed only through consumption, only through when they purchase something, when they use some service or something like that. Therefore, such taxes are known as indirect tax. These are simple things. You can understand economics if you listen. You can become economist, big economist. Only thing is that you must understand simple things. So this indirect tax is tax on the common people. Direct tax is tax on the rich people because that is direct on wealth and income, profit, etc. Well, real, all the speculation, capital gains, all these are direct tax. So in imperialist countries today, though they are capitalist, even now, in spite of the collapse of the welfare state is collapsed. It collapsed in the 70s. Even after that collapse, even now, imperialism abandoned welfare state. Communist movement, international left, because of the setbacks, ideological, political setbacks of the left, imperialism abandoned welfare state. They adopted neoliberal policies. Still, taxes in these countries are such that 60% of the tax is direct, 40% is indirect. What is in the Indian case? India, more than 60% of the tax is indirect. It less than 40% is direct. That is Indian situation. So, in the neoliberal period, that is after the 90s, international capital, World Bank, IMF, then other international agencies, they made a tax reform, global tax reform, for pushing the burden of taxation to the shoulders of common people. More burden. That is what is called the GST, Goods and Services Tax. GST is a tax reform, a neoliberal tax reform invented by international neoliberal experts for liberalizing tax regime, for making tax more liberal to the corporates, making tax burden less to the corporates and more to the common people. So that tax reform is implemented in India by Narendra Modi. How? How the economic crisis comes, that is what I am explaining. By calling a midnight session of the Indian Parliament in June 30th, 2007, after demonetization. Demonetization took in, occurred in, implemented in 2016, Next year he implemented what is called GST. Special session of the parliament. Why? The special session of Indian parliament was first called in 1947 midnight for power transfer. Transferring power from colonial Britain to Indian masters or Indian rulers. In 2017, a second midnight session of Indian Parliament was called for another power transfer. So this midnight session of Parliament is for power transfer. Transferring power to somebody. Here, this tax imposing that power of taxation was taken away from the state governments. In India constitutionally, India is a country where states have their constitution has assigned certain powers to states. It's a federal country. At least in principle, because every Tamil Nadu has its own powers of taxation. How resources can be mobilized, what are the sources, sales tax, other taxes, it has certain taxes. So generally, two-thirds of the taxes of the states are collected by the states themselves. It is not a share from central. It is not a share from the central government. More than two-thirds of the taxes are states' own taxes. So this power of the states was taken away and given to the corporates. Because the corporate companies were given power, that means India became a unified market where the state government's power was taken away and the power of taxation was vested with an extra parliamentary body known as GST Council. No parliamentary supervision is there. This GST Council is composed of corporate nominees plus the finance minister, central finance, some others. There is no parliamentary scrutiny. It is a constitutional change. So the state government's tax resource mobilization capacity, power has been taken away forever. And that is what is called the second power transfer. I am not going into those details. Because of that, the medium-sized companies, small companies, small industrialists, retailers who are contributing to 50% of India's export. India is a country where 50% of the export earnings are coming from medium-sized and small industries. Such industries were enjoying several tax exemptions, privileges, etc. Those privileges, exemptions, everything were taken away. It was Tamil, only one government at that time has some difference was Tamil Nadu government. Reason is not because of the Tamil Nadu governments, because of that national consciousness. So Tamil Nadu actually opposed, but nobody was there. No government in India, state government in India was there to oppose GST. There is a government in Kerala, a government led by CPIM. They were the first government in India to support Modi. The Kerala government led by CPIM, Pinarayi Vijayan and the finance minister Thomas Isaac, they went to support Modi first for GST. So no opposition was there, GST was imposed. So as a result of GST, what happened is the small scale industries or the whole retail industries, they collapsed. Because tax burden was more on them and the people also. Kerala is experiencing a severe crisis today because the whole, because it was, they said that it is a consumption based economy, so tax will go up. What happened was that there is a collapse. So because of this reason, the crisis intensively. So I am turning to another aspect. So because of these factors, when after Modi coming, because of GST, demonetization, the economy collapsed. And because of the collapse of the productive sphere, because of the collapse of the agriculture industry and productive sphere, employment has gone down, people's real earnings have gone down, and this is finally reflected in the speculative sphere also. So total collapse. There is one more thing. When Narendra Modi came in 2014, 45% of the national wealth generated in India in 1 year went to 1% of the super rich. Super rich means the billionaire class. The super rich, 1% of the super rich people, corporate billionaires, 1% of the top sections, they had their share in national income generated was almost 45% when Modi came in 2014. In 2017, according to economic estimates, under Modi's rule, 59% of the national income generated went to 1% of the super rich. In 2018-17, that means the next year, 73% of the national income generated went to the 1% of the super rich. You imagine what happens. I am not simply making a story here, I am making facts. 73% of the national wealth generated in India in 1 year went to the super rich 1% of the people. So you can imagine, India became one of the most unequal countries in the world under the Modi government. One of the most unequal countries, inequality became so high. So many world reports have come. 53% of the Indian people are suffering from multi-dimensional poverty. So many estimates are. Global hunger index of 119 countries examined, India's position in 2018 was 103. Of total 119 countries studied, their case studied, out of that, India's position was 103, that means 103. Nepal, 76. Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, all countries were above India. So, India, the big, we are going to become the biggest world power. So, here global hunger index, this is a measurement. Corruption. India became the most corrupt country in Asia under Modi. Modi said, what he said? After he is coming to power, he will catch all the black money in foreign banks. Take back this money from foreign banks and he will put 15 lakh rupees in the account of all Indian citizens each. 15 lakh to comrade, to comrade, to comrade, to comrade. Every Indian, their account, 15 lakhs will be, these are his speech. That means that much money is in foreign banks, black money, corrupt money. So under his rule, corruption became so high that there is a, these are not communists or Marxists, Oxfam, a global agency. That agency's name is known as Oxfam. According to their study, India became the most corrupt country in Asia, pushing Pakistan, Thailand behind Asia. So a man, a ruler, he came to claiming that he will put all the corrupt in the jail. So this is party, this is fascism. So fascists will use all popular things. They will utilize popular sentiments. They will organize people against the existing anti, they will take an anti-establishmentarian position. But actually what will happen when they once establish power, they will abolish, they will become the chosen agents of the most corrupt corporate class. This is the crisis. So this is the crisis that we are facing today. At a global level also, the crisis is arising from this point. What is the point? Because now when we examine this question, we must answer. What is the problem today? I am going to make a certain comments on that problem. The point is simple. Today, capital is entering into speculation. It is not entering into production. And all avenues, all facilities for speculation are opened up. No treatment, no favorable situation for production is there. Employment generation is going down because if workers are employed, then they should be given wages. Now they made workers, these contract workers, they made workers informal. The world today, you know, not only in India, all over the world, the number of informal working class is going up. Formal working class, organized working class is becoming less and less. Unorganized, informal working class, their number is increasing. Nobody is there to organize them. No unions are going to organize them. Their wages are going down. Even so-called organized sector also informalization is going on. Even minimum wage, 8-hour working time. So all these hard-earned rights of workers are taken away. 44 labor laws in India are abolished and 4 courts have been coming into being. You know, 44 labor laws are abolished. Ecological crisis. Corporates are allowed to plunder the nature, unrestricted plunder of nature. So corporates are unleashed. They are given all freedom in the name of growth. But actually, no growth is there. Speculative sphere is developing and that is collapsing. So the problem today, our economy at a global level is facing is that capital is once you left capital free. When you free capital, because capital is inherently, capital today is inherent, it has become reactionary. Historically, Lenin pointed out in the early 20th century that capitalism has become imperialism, it has become reactionary, it has become parasitic, it has become moribund. It cannot lead even capitalistic order because it is going, capitalism itself is collapsing because of the operations of finance capital. So in the Second World War, I am concluding, in the Second World War, after the Second World War, because of the global situation, anti-colonial, as I have already said, anti-national liberation movements, then advancement of the working class, capitalism was compelled, capitalist countries, imperialism was compelled to impose restrictions on this corporate capital, finance capital. You know the theoretician, that economist in whose name welfare state has come, Keynes. He said that his phrase, I am quoting his phrase, he asked for a euthanasia for speculative capital. Euthanasia means mercy killing. You know euthanasia? Mercy killing, that means you must kill. This is a capitalist. Keynes said, asked him, what is your opinion about Marxism and capital? He said that it is a dull book, not usable for anything. That is his comment. So he has contempt for Marxism. That man said that if capitalism is to survive, then capitalism should declare a euthanasia, a mercy killing for speculation, speculative capital. So that is why in USA, all over the world, imperialism enforced certain restrictions on capital. That is what is called welfare state. But after the 70s, I am concluding, after the 70s, what happened, you know, there is a setback for international communist movement. But the 70s capitalism again underwent a crisis, because crisis is inherent in capitalism. In the 30s welfare state they adopted, but that cannot maintain capital. It is only when you have a disease, you have a stomach pain, you take one tablet, then it will reflect in a headache in the bone, then another disease. It will go from crisis to crisis. That is capitalism. So 30s a crisis was there, they adopted welfare state. 70s another crisis, it is known as stagflation. Several names are there, because in the 30s it was deflation, depression. In the 70s, depression plus inflation, stagflation, stagnation plus inflation. So new problems will be there. So to tide over that, to overcome that, what imperialism did? Neoliberalism. I will conclude within 5 to 10 minutes. I will conclude within 5 to 10 minutes, because we, this is an elaborate topic, we can discuss any extent, but I am concluding. In the 70s, when a new crisis come, international situation was different. 30s opposition was there. So capitalists adopted a policy by which they have to survive, otherwise communism will advance. So what they did in the 70s, communists were, because of their ideological political weakness, they have nothing to offer. Soviet Union had become already gone to capitalism. China was along the capitalist road. No socialist countries were in the world. And internationally, the international left, international communist movement was in a, what is called, in disarray. Ideology was there, but actually there was no force. Taking advantage of the situation, Thatcherism came, Reaganomics came, neoliberalism came. They unleashed the power of corporate capital. All controls over corporate speculation was taken away. Internationally, free capital movements were there. Capital can move anywhere. Free entry and exit, can enter, can go. Any country. So that is what is called a free international movement of capital. No restriction. So it can enter into stock market. It can come into money market. It can go out. It can make profit and repatriate. That is the collapse of the rupee, you know. What is the problem? Our rupee is now, there is no control over the exchange rate. Governments control over the value, reserve banks control over the fixing the value of the rupee has already taken away. There is no control. Now the value of the rupee is determined by speculators. Currency speculate. Every sphere, currency speculators, the money market, currency market, their speculators are ruling. Currency speculators, their name may be different. So this currency speculation is the result leading to the decline of the value of the rupee. Because when foreign exchange is coming in, when there are more foreign exchange is there, what will happen? When there is more supply, what do you know, simple economics. When there is more supply, price will go down. When there is abundance, price will go down. So when more foreign exchange, when dollars, more money come in, more foreign currency come in, the price of dollar will go down, so that the price of rupee will go up. This is simple, I am saying. Simple thing. So when this foreign exchange goes out, when foreign exchange is going out, because there is no control on foreign exchange by government. Hot money, you know, hot money, you have heard about hot money. Hot money, money is now becoming, it is within split seconds. Within split seconds, money can, from India, thousands of crores, thousands of billions of crores of foreign exchange can, dollar can move to New York Stock Exchange. Within split seconds, simply you press the button of a computer. That is sufficient. So that they no control. So the value of rupee is going down, because from the Indian market, foreign exchange, dollar is going out. And if it is coming in, then the value of rupee will going up. So there is no control. Capital is controlling everything. international capital is controlling, private corporates are controlling. So what happened from the 70s onward, 80s, 90s, so from the 90s onward in our country until 90s, 80s, we had some restrictions in the Nehruvian model. So Manmohan Singh came, he abolished all the Nehruvian mask. Then after 10 years he became finance minister, prime minister. The policies continued. Then at that time BJP was in the opposition. Even though Vajpayee started 1998 too, you know, Vajpayee was ruling the first BJP led government. Second generation of globalization, they started GST, they started this. It is Vajpayee government which started the VAT first, then GST later. What do you know? Value added tax. It is tax on goods. GST, goods and services, additional on services, because in the Indian economy, 60%, more than 60% of the economy is composed of services, not production. Service sector. 60% of the Indian economy is service sector. So service tax, from that sphere, now people are, what is called, they are plundered more from tax on the service sector. Wherever you do, whatever service you seek, you have to pay tax, you know. So this service tax, that is goods and service tax, that is implemented by Vajpayee. And Vajpayee was very, very prudent. He's a very far-sighted man. Therefore, he appointed West Bengal finance minister at that time, Asim Das Gupta. He came from MIT, American Massachusetts Institute of Technology. So he appointed, he discussed with Jyothi Basu, and Jyothi Basu gave Asim Das Gupta as the chairman of the empowered committee for implementing VAT and GST. Up to 2008, this Asim Das Gupta continued as the chairman of the empowered committee for implementation of GST. This is only one example. So continued. Then Modi, he opposed these policies. He said that it is anti-national. When Manmohan Singh opened FDI, he said that it is anti-national. When Manmohan Singh tried to implement GST, he said that it is against the people. But what he was doing in Gujarat, you know, Adani. Adani was nowhere in Indian picture until the 90s. We heard about Tata, Birla, Goenka, such capitalists. These people, these Adani, this type of new capitalists came because of this neoliberal period. And in the Gujarat, in Forbes magazine, Forbes is a London-based magazine, is there, it is monthly. His name is Forbes, Forbes magazine. There, an article, a study was there. They found that nowhere in economic history a company has multiplied its wealth by 13 times, 1,300% within 10 years. That is Adani. Adani, under Modi, in Gujarat, when Modi was the chief minister, Adani multiplied his properties, asset, by 13 times within 10 years. 13 times within 10 years. So after Modi became the Indian Prime Minister, he extended this Gujarat model. He actually took a pan-Indian extension. That may be the correct phrase. Pan-Indian extension of the Gujarat model to all India situation, that what we are experiencing today. And I am concluding, when we speak about fascism, of course, there are, it's, you know, there are different in Europe, it may be, there may be Zionism in Israel, evangelism in Americas, racism in Europe. So in different countries, different these reactionary ideologies can act as the base, ideological basis. But the economic foundation is very important. When surplus value when capital cannot extract value through normal methods. Clear? Normal methods of exploitation, normal methods of surplus value extraction, if not possible, then what will do capitalists? Then they will use the state machinery in an appropriate manner. So the state machinery, the state apparatus, the bourgeois state apparatus, they will utilize the bourgeois state apparatus by merging, by integrating with the bourgeois state machinery. So that is fascism. Among other aspects are also there. I am concentrating on the economic aspect now. Other aspects are also relevant. If only economics, it may not be correct. But when fascism means it is close integration of corporate capital with the bourgeois state machinery. So now the integration, the merger of the corporates and the state are so intense. It is fully merged, integrated. And so that's so normal surplus extraction, surplus value extraction is not possible. Therefore, they need new methods, new oppression, new type of plunder, new type of what is called financial tyranny on the people. So that is fascism. So in Kashmir, I am 1-2 minutes, I will finish. In Kashmir also, you examine what is going on. Kashmir, I used to say, our friends, you might have heard about the Pakistan Foreign Minister's speech. Pakistan Foreign Minister said, we failed to seek the support of the international, i.e. other countries. Because Modi succeeded because international capital is more interested in Indian market. In Kashmir, October 12 to 14, it is now postponed. It is postponed now. Modi was planning a global investors meet in Kashmir. It is October 12 to October 14. Now it is postponed. Today's paper or yesterday's paper, it is postponed because the conditions are not favorable now. So they are planning to have a global investors meet in Kashmir. Why the Kashmir 370 is abolished and 35A? Because you know, as per the 1947-48 agreement, India, at that time there is an agreement that because the Kashmir people, they were majority of the Kashmir, as per the understanding, Muslim majority areas will go to Pakistan, Hindu majority areas will go to India. But the king at that time, all these things you know, very simple, the king took a decision that he joined India. So Pakistan attacked, so many problems were there. So in 1948, there was an understanding. What is the understanding? There should be a referendum, a plebiscite, that is the UN understanding. And the understanding and the Article 370 says that, 335A says that nobody else other than Kashmiris cannot purchase property in Kashmir. 370 says certain regulations by which corporates have restrictions in Kashmir. Now that restriction is being taken away. October 12 to 14, they planned a global investors meeting. Which country is hosting? Who are involved? The leader of Islamic Arab world, Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia has already invested or purchased the 20% of the shares, wealth, asset of the biggest corporate in India. Who is the biggest corporate? Ambani. So Ambani's wealth, asset, 20% of Ambani's wealth is purchased by Aramco. Aramco is the biggest international oil company situated in Saudi Arabia. So Saudi Arabian Aramco has purchased 20% of Reliance share. So along with Aramco, Saudi, Reliance is given the responsibility, Ambani has given the responsibility for holding global investors meet in Kashmir. Confederation of Indian industry will be there. All international capital will come. That is why Pakistan Foreign Minister said that we failed. Because Narendra Modi succeeded because international capital is the key that we must understand. whenever we speak about fascism, anything, it is the corporate finance capital. It was in Germany also, here also, everywhere. That is communist approach. Fascism is the foundation. That when I started my speech, I told you that I am explaining the crisis with respect to that, explain that is the foundation of fascism. So today the fascistization, the Indian fascism, corporate suffering fascism, Indian fascism, it is fascism, no doubt. So it is, some people will say whether fascism has come or coming. No, it is Indian fascism. It is, they will, of course, today they can use a parliamentary edifice, no problem. It was not in the 30s. Now the parliamentary edifice can be maintained, an envelope can be maintained, and they can do what they want. So the corporates are flocking to capital. Hey, Kashmir. So yeah, there also, these corporate interests are there. So the crisis is that way. We should understand. We must approach the crisis that we are facing with respect to the operation of these capitalist, this finance capital, corporate capital, their greed, their speculation, and the laws of motion of capital. The laws of motion of corporate capital. So we have to link it in that way to understand the present crisis, and it is against the people. So the only the working class, the peasants, the oppressed. So only there, from the grassroots, from the people, there is no other alternative. So the only alternative is the working class, the peasants, the people, progressive democratic forces, they should come forward to put forward an alternative. That is the only alternative. I am not going into the details. So I thank you very much for giving a patient attention to what, in spite of a language which is not in your mother tongue. I am sorry that I was forced to say in English, and my English is also not so good. So because still you have a patient hearing, thank you very much. From my presentation, it is very clear that the system is going from crisis to crisis and not from crisis to tranquility or peace. It is going from crisis to crisis. So within this system, which is controlled by corporate capital, according to the laws of motion of, according to the logic of corporate capital, things are going on. Even the latest announcement by our finance minister is in accordance with the corporatization. Actually, the problem is corporatization induced stagnation. Clear? Our stagnation, our economic crisis, our economic recession, our economic slowdown, our economic tsunami, whatever name you call, this economic crisis is due to the economic stagnation, is corporatization is induced. It is because of corporatization. And you said that our infrastructure development is there, but what type of infrastructure development we have? It is highly skewed. This infrastructure development is not oriented to the democratic development of the people, no. What they are, you see, this infrastructure development itself is the cause for crisis. Non-performing assets, recently Reserve Bank study is there. This PPP model, which I haven't gone into those aspects. Public-private partnership, public-private partnership, PPP model. After Modi came to power, India became the biggest PPP market in the world. With 1,000 PPP projects. Nowhere in the country, 1,000 PPP infrastructure projects are running. Public-private partner. You take any aerodrome, port, national highway, metro, anything you take. Every infrastructure development, social overheads, everything is on PPP model. This PPP model is the biggest source of corporate accumulation today. You take the, because this is an important question which needs explanation, because you stress the infrastructure. You see, take the case of road, national highway. What is the 1 kilometer for constructing 1 kilometer of road according to National Highway Authority estimation? 6 crores to 7 crores. 7 crore rupees are sufficient for constructing 1 kilometer of road average. This is in some area it may be high, in some area it may be low. On an average, 1 kilometer of road can be constructed in India by National Highway Authority estimate by spending 7 crores. But if you take the PPP model, which is where the PPP model means the consultancy, the company, it is actually the corporates. Under that model, 21 to 23 crores per kilometer, National Highway, you examine. According to PPP model, if the government of India is constructing road, this is the cost. According to the PPP model, you have to spend 21 to 23 crores per kilometer. From where this money comes, that is interesting. Every PPP project, 40% will be grant from the government. Government of India will give grant 40%. That means how much of 21 crores, how much 40% will come to how much? 8 crores, 9 crores. That is not required for spending, constructing one road by government. So government will give 40% of the estimated. This is inflated. Inflated estimate. So government will give that to this company. Okay. And the company, how the money is raised? The corporate company can go to bank. Bank managers are standing in queue to give money based on goodwill. No security is needed. If Ambani Adani calls a manager, then money will be sent to the corporate godowns in truck loads. Truck will go with the money. No security. If a peasant is a small worker, if a small trader, if an industry, if he for a loan, no. But the corporates will be given loan on the basis of goodwill. No security is needed. So the banks will give money. So for Reserve Bank has made a study that the PPP model is behind non-performing assets. Clear. So PPP model is has destroyed banks. And this is a neoliberal form of plunder. Neoliberal form of accumulation PPP project. Corporates are given money by the government and by the banks. After that, the story is not finished. After this, money from banks, it will not be repaid because the corporate company will make profit. It will not be repaid. Even Narendra Modi, nobody will take any action against this corporate. It will not be repaid. After completion of the project, there will be tax toll. That toll will be several times. We have made certain studies. For a portion of the National Highway there in Kerala, 317 crores spent in PPP, as per PPP estimate, but 17,000 crores will be the collection through toll. This is neoliberal form of accumulation. And you see, whether the state government, where your Chief Minister Palaniswamy, Edappadi Palaniswamy, whether he will be given loan by State Bank of India, Edappadi Palaniswamy will be given loan. The state government goes to State Bank of India. Whether the State Bank of India will give it loan? No. Palaniswamy has to go to Asian Development Bank or World Bank. State Bank of India will give loan to Adani and Ambani. It will not give to Palaniswamy, who is elected by the people. This is neoliberalism. So you see, this infrastructure model is there. So that is collapsed, already collapsed. So point is, you asked me, what is the scope? Okay, there is no scope within the system. Within this law, there is no scope. It will go from crisis to crisis. But nobody is speaking. Nobody is, those who know, the corporate media is silent. Intellectuals are silent. Economists are silent. Mainstream parties are silent. That is the question. So it is on the people. It is only the people. Only the common, the working class, the people, they alone can take it. what is called a political position, an alternate. There is no scope within the system. And I am again not quoting Lenin. Lenin said, people said that this will collapse on its own. No. That they will overcome the crisis. Nirmala Sitharaman came, they made some window dressing, again plunder will go on, until being thrown away, these anti-people policies, they will be continuing. They will continue. So you have to defeat it. You have to politically intervene and throw them away. Unless you do that, they will put heavier and heavier burdens on the people. So for me, there is no scope within the system. The only scope is to demolish the system and you try for a new people's alternative.
Sir, you are referring to China
is actually integrated into international capital after Mao's death. When Deng Xiaoping came, he put four modernizations, and the advantage of China was, one, China is not like India. The way in which China is, what that is I am explaining, China is a sovereign independent country. It has already de-linked itself from international capital. 1949, because completion of Chinese Revolution, China de-linked from capital. India is actually depending. Indian ruling classes are depending on, you know, imperialism, policy. China is independent. It marked it as a clear direction, but after some change, remains took place. So China, abandoning socialism, it turned to capitalism. But that capitalism is with Chinese own legs, Chinese characteristics. In international, it is not depending on in the imperialism. But after something, what happened? Capitalism today is imperialism. Capitalism means it is imperialism. So when China, led by bureaucrat, you know, today Communist Party can itself become a bureaucratic party. That is a problem that communists are facing. Communism can become a, Communist Party can become a bureaucrat. That is what China is, you know. So that is a major problem that we have discussed. So China, led by the bureaucrats, state capitalism, that means bureaucratic capitalism, after some time what has happened, it has its laws. Now you allied with the state bureaucracy, you know, what is his name, that Alibaba,
Jack Ma,
that biggest
Alibaba,
yeah, correct. So such big corporate companies are evolving in China, and they are actually pioneers in several fields, which I earlier mentioned that Modi has to depend on China. Even Indian currency was printed by China for a time. So the problem is that Chinese people, Chinese economy, China is actually intervening in international market on its own. And the advantage of China is cheap labor. Cheap labor. So Chinese capitalists are capable of making huge surplus value profits by utilizing the cheap labor from China, because China, there is no labor laws. There was socialism, so but now after socialism is no more, the Chinese working class is more exploited than India, because here at least we had some laws. There the situation is that there is no regulation, no law, even ecology, everything. China is the situation is so serious, even waste, one third of the whole land area is dumped as waste, deposited as, so many questions are there. So Chinese capitalism succeeded in capturing international market through exports. China's foreign exchange reserve today is almost 3 to 4, today it might have been gone down, I don't know the latest estimate. 2 years back we got an estimate, there are $3 to $4 trillion China's foreign exchange reserve. It is three times than that of Indian national income. So that much foreign exchange reserve was there. So China is the source of export to America. American capitalists are actually, American economy is depending on cheap Chinese imports. Okay. Walmart. the biggest American
hypermarket,
super that retail market, retail company, world's biggest retail, the world's biggest multinational. World's biggest multinational company is not a production-oriented company. It is Walmart, the biggest retailer. That Walmart has procuring 65% of its products from China, from Chinese sources, cheap. And it is selling these products internationally. So that way China is integrated. So Chinese capitalism is in a different way. They are also real estate. They are also money spending businesses. They are also, because capitalism has its rules. Where in China or in America, capital is capital. So it has its own rules, but it is different. But China is now trying to grab international market. It is by, you know, it is a Belt and Road program. Everywhere it is expanding, and so it is conducting with US imperialism for world market. And in many areas, China has already advanced. And so that is why the basis of protection, you know, this protectionism, trade war, protectionist war against US imperialism, that is going on. So the integration with Chinese integration with the international capital is different. But basic law is the same, but specificities, concrete way in which it is functioning is different. That we have to examine in detail, we will discuss, but for the time I have limitation.
Sir, why fugitive Vijay Mallya only specified? No fugitive has specified like Ambani and so many
defaulters. Actually, I got this information when Swiss, this Credit Suisse, there is a Swiss agency, his name is known as given the names of 10 leading leading companies responsible for non-performing assets. Number one, this name of the company is Credit Suisse, S-U-I-S-S-I-E, Credit Suisse. That is the name of the company. You can look at the website. So according to that report, number one is Ambani, number two is Adani, number three is SR, Videocon. So similar, there are 10 companies are there. You can see there, Mallya and all this comes very low. Very low. But they have, because they have, it's own low, because Mallya and Meenamoli, they may have their own. But these big sharks are there, they are the government, they are the state itself, they are so much integrated. So they need not go out.
They may be close partners.
Yes. And even Modi, you know, comrade, these are so many facts are there, you have to explain. When Modi went to Australia, you know, there was a lady in the flight, you know, all these things. But when closely examined, it was proved that it was Arindhati Bhattacharya, the chairperson, the state bank chairperson at that time, you know, for signing. Arindhati Bhattacharya was taken in Modi's flight when he was going to Australia to sign the agreement with Adani's coal that plant in Australia, you know. So for signing the paper, she went. So these are there, the close integration with our public sector state. And these corporates are there. So they, one section, big sharks will survive. Small sharks will be, they will collapse. That is the law, capitalism is law.
The law is going on in India.
That law is going on. Yeah. And there one more, and this problem, say this integration, that is what is called crony, that means this close integration with the political leadership and the corporate class, then their name cannot be disclosed. Even we are saying that Raghuram Rajan is also neoliberal. He is also, but he says that some regulation should be there, some strategies. When Modi's economies are making doctored, manipulated strategies, Raghuram Rajan and Arvind Subramanian, former chief economist, the Reserve Bank governors, they will say that, no, strategies should be perfect. This is not correct. That is what they are saying. Okay, so what he said? Raghuram Rajan actually asked Modi government to disclose the names of the defaulters. But Modi was not ready. Okay, so the differences came, he went. So these are there. If you are big enough to manipulate the system, if you are big enough to manipulate the judicial, if you are big enough to manipulate the administrative, the entire state military, then you will succeed. If you are not big enough, then you will fail. That is the law of capital.
The corporate has taken the form of saffron fascism in India.
Yes, correct.
That's the question of you.
It is 100% correct. That's what I am saying. So Indian corporates are saffronized. The saffron fascism means the Brahminical ideology, the Indian corporates, they have they have embraced the Brahminical ideology and the saffronized everything, every sphere is saffronized. Military, judiciary, civil service, state apparatus, everything is being saffronized. And the corporates are, because the Indian history, you know, the low caste people, the oppressed, the Dalits, the untouchable, they have no right to property. So historically, in India, propertied class is the saffron class, I mean the Brahminical class. So naturally all the leading corporates are suffragists, and the RSS has a history of a century. Unlike Modi and Mussolini and Hitler, this RSS is having a century. So they from the 30s onward, they betrayed the national independence struggle, they allied with the Britain, then after the power transfer, they were the biggest American when gold worker. When Vietnam War was going on, when world was isolating America, America was isolated, nobody was there to support America. At that time, gold worker sent a letter, Vajpayee was the opposition leader, a letter was sent to Vajpayee to give to Lyndon Johnson. So Vajpayee took that letter to Lyndon Johnson, and their gold worker supported that, the world's number one criminal, international policeman, who is responsible for the neo-colonial world order. So America, the RSS will be with America. So after that neoliberalism, now you know what is in Republican Hindu coalition in USA, just like Jewish lobby, a Republican Hindu coalition is taking there. So internationally, RSS, all suffering forces, they are united with imperialism. In India also, the ideologically, politically, militarily, everywhere, the RSS has started military school, and their school they will be training, and from there army generals will be recruited. Manu court has been started. Every age is fully suffering. I have no doubt.
Sir,
thanks for the enlightening lecture. I have a question. I mean, with the development of this crisis of the political establishment, there is a growth of this right-wing forces across the world. At the same time, there are support, a massive support from the workers and from the people towards left forces as well. I mean, it's been reported recently that socialism is no longer a dirty word or something out of the political mainstream. It's coming towards in America and in England. There are left reformists who call themselves as democratic socialists, putting forward more or less Keynesian reformist policies and campaigning for an alternative, and they are getting massive support. But there are far left in those places, in America, Western Europe, who are calling for a socialist platform. They are revolutionary socialists, basically. What they are calling for is to take over the big companies and industries under the democratic control of the working class forces. This is the campaign they are putting forward. But we don't have a clear-cut vision on that. I mean, we are still having this new democratic revolution and sort of these platforms, rather than coming against a real alternative against the big capitalists.
Very clear.
Second point, along with that, You said fascism has this economical outlet, means a factor, which you explained. At the same time, fascism is a system which is established after the annihilation of the working class forces, when the working class is defeated. So here, it may appear the working class is defeated, but it's still a significant force. Around 20 million workers have demonstrated against Modi's regime. I mean, it's still the leadership is not that great, but still they are a forces. They are the forces who can be rallied against this far right. So we are not yet going to that fascist.
Correct. I can clearly understand your point. And probably, can I take 10 minutes? It's a very serious question that he has raised. So one point he has raised is that at a global level, because my topic is economic crisis. So that is why I concentrated on that topic. What you said is also very important. So comrade said that internationally neo-Keynesian, that I understand, a neo-Keynesian offensive is there, that I am putting my word, a neo-Keynesian offensive is there, that a return to the welfare state, I am very precise, return to the welfare state, and there are struggles are going on all over the world, the workers, democracy, social democracy, sir. So all these are there. There is one point I have in point around that, correct. Number two, he said that working class, I said that working class is totally nowhere, but working class is resisting, that is coming, the alternative is there. So on that question, my position, I think that I have briefly put your point. Now on that question, my point is that this is only a going back to neo-Keynesianism or a going back to the welfare state. That option, because it's a history, when you understand, when capital is becoming more and more reactionary. So within this system, the scope for adjustment is becoming less and less. So going back to a welfare state, going back to a neo-Keynesian policies, that such policies, that means the system is capitalist, private property based, imperialist system is still there, but within that system, a reformist alternative is putting forward. So that scope for that reformist alternative is becoming less and less, that is number one. Rahul Gandhi, after meeting Piketty, you have seen that according to his position, Thomas Piketty, a neo-Keynesian, he met him and he sought advice and he suggested in his manifesto minimum alternate tax, minimum, that means minimum guaranteed income, sorry, minimum guaranteed income. So minimum guaranteed income means the imperialist system will prevail, neoliberal policies will continue, but within that system you can still, there is scope for adjustment. That is a reformist alternative, that is what comrade said. I agree with you, there is a trend, but my position is that the scope of that trend to succeed and the success of that trend is very limited, and we have again, it will lead to another crisis because it is connected with the laws of motion of capital. Capitalism, it is not purely economic, it is political, cultural, everything. It is not a pure economistic explanation. So that is number one. That is why it should be explained in detail. Number two is, you said that in India, you said about 20 crores of people fighting against this. This is a kind of every year a ceremony, death ceremony, every celebration, like that. Every year, this is a ritual. What is the political leadership who are leading this? What is their approach to neoliberal policies? Whether they have any alternative to neoliberal policies? What we have seen in Bengal? 34 years they ruled Bengal. 34 years. And finally, only most of them have become part of BJP. So all those so-called lefty people, they became part of BJP. No alternative for them. They implemented the same neoliberal policies. They became corporatized. So they were part of the corporate system in Kerala, that they are doing the same. They are competing with the Modi government for implementing corporatization. they went to London Stock Exchange for inviting the corporate capital to Kerala. So corporate speculation is going on. 57% of the whole land is controlled by foreign companies, Binamis. They are fighting, they are against the constitution. They are against, I am saying, they are against the constitution, they are against economic, the country's sovereignty. And a left government is there. No, nothing is done. We are fighting against that. We are fighting against for acquisition of, capture of that land. It is illegal. No, Leo is needed. Simply you can take. But 57% of the land is held by Harrison and London-based companies even now. As part of colonial agreement, it is already cancelled. So illegal. So these people, the social democrats, you see, it is before the Second World War, you anti-fascist struggle for Komodai, if you want, you can read. Dimitrov, who led the anti-fascist struggle, he, and in the last speech, in the 7th Congress of the Comintern, Dimitrov had a long speech. He said, the anti-fascist struggle has a limitation. You cannot depend on the social democrats. Because Lenin, Stalin said, because I have to say, because this is politics, Stalin said, these social democrats are the moderate wing of fascism. Moderate wing of fascism. Because they have no alternative, they are depending on capitalist policies. So dependence on capitalist policies, adding capitalist policies, now neoliberal policies, more degeneration. So when capitalism is degenerating, more and more degeneration, in Lenin's time, speculation here thousandfold. Speculation, degeneration, parasitism is increasing. So you, this system itself is rotten. You cannot survive within the system. So an alternative is needed. That doesn't mean, I agree with the comrade, we should unite with all progressive forces who are against neoliberalism. I agree. But the social democratic leadership in our country, they are exponents of neoliberal policies. Wherever they comes to power, they are implementing the same neoliberal policies that lead them to destruction, that lead them to liquidation, as we have seen in Bengal. Therefore, one alternative, and in that process, we have to seek several policies, I agree. We cannot all of a sudden, we cannot come make socialism. We have to, but we should have a broader, immediate program, a long-term program, I agree. We should have an immediate problem. So I am not a sectarian, as you said. This, I am saying that we should have a democratic approach with an immediate program and a long-term program. In the immediate program, I agree with you, all the workers, all progressive sections, we should, but politically, simply you are ritualistic, things won't work. You politically organize the working class, you come to the lead, working class should come to the leadership. They should resist the neoliberal policies, and in that process, we should unite with all. But the ideological leadership of the struggle cannot be given to social democrats. That is the point. That is only the point.
Sir,
maybe,
Comrade, I have one question.
Ah.
Today, this is the time where the economic crisis is creating the fascism or fascist, or the fascist are replacing this crisis to overcome. So this is my simple question.
These are comment. This is a very simple thing also. Your question is simple. The answer is also simple. It is integrated, you see. It is not a purely economic phenomenon. No economistic. I agree with our friend. My explanation, my presentation here was on a topic, economic crisis. You see, you cannot have an economistic explanation. It's a political, ideological. You ask people, you see, people send himself, the fascists are, they are using people, it is not a single thing. Majority of the people are supporting. Popular support is there. So people are de-ideologized. No politicization is there. Politicization of the working class, politicization of the people are not there, is not there. Therefore, people are depoliticized. So they are losing faith in the system. So the fascists are capable of putting slogans which are catchy, which are short, which have no, so they can effectively use popular sentiments. That is the problem. So when the crisis, that is the foundation, when the crisis intensifies, naturally the scapegoats, who are the responsible minorities, migrants, or that people, these people, this type of using the majoritarian, using the homogeneous section of the population, majoritarian section of the population, putting against them the heterogeneous section, the minorities, and these are trends. So a homogeneous, a majoritarian thing will be used by the superstructure, by the political leadership. So I cannot say which is, so for example, even before these economic crisis, RSS was there, they were there, they were ready, they stood for Manuspriti as the constitution in 1947, you know. The organizer, RSS mouthpiece, there in 1949 and 1950, articles were published that Manuspriti should be the Indian constitution. They asked. So now they are implementing it. They can implement it. So in that way, that force is there. So they have only one thing, Hindu Rashtra. But now this Hindu Rashtra is making its basis as the corporatization. So it is interlinked. So which is first, which is second, that is not the question. Analytically, these are interlinked, these are historical, political, cultural, ideological. So all these factors are integrated. So I cannot, it is not proper to say economics is first, politics is first, or which came first, which came last. You should have an objective, concrete analysis according to the concrete situation. The situation in Europe before Second World War, you cannot have a test copy, a stereotyped version of fascism today. It will be different. Depending on the concrete situation in India. So you should have a general understanding. You should apply this general understanding to the concrete Indian situation. Then you analyze. So I am also saying that they came, that came first, this came first, I will not say. What you said, what our friend said, all are, there are truths, there are facts. So we as Democrats, we as who are with the people, we may have our difference. Those difference we can debate, we can discuss, but we should have a minimum program. On the basis of that minimum program, let us move. Okay, we should have a minimum program, democratic program. Then we can have ideological debate. We can, we are, okay. Which is true, we should have a concrete analysis. If you accept that approach, then okay. Clear? That we can debate, discuss.
Only there and the government take
1,76,000
money.
Okay. That point, so many aspects are there. Reserve Bank of India, government said 1.76 lakh crores of Reserve Bank money. It is because you see tax, as a result of GST alone, there is a 10% reduction in indirect tax collection. 10% reduction means average tax collection in an year is 12 lakh crore, something like that. So there, this lakh, this 10% means it is more than 1 lakh crore. Reduction in indirect tax collection is there. So the governmental revenue is declining. IMF regulation is that there you should have fiscal deficit within limits, as you know. IMF regulation is there. Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act is passed by the government as per IMF direction. Therefore, the government is duty bound to keep the fiscal deficit in a limit. So to keep the fiscal deficit in limit, the Nirmala Sitharaman's budget was followed. There was a gap of big, that means gap was there. This mobilization, resource mobilization gap was there. So to feel that they are going after the Reserve Bank. Now Reserve Bank is having 9.6 lakh crores of rupees as its surplus. So the understanding was that profit of Reserve Bank should be handed over. So Modi is taking profits of Reserve Bank from 2014 onward. The whole profit of RBI is taken every year. This is in addition to that, the reserve of RBI is now being taken. So it is a crisis. It shows the crisis. It shows the crisis. So the crisis is so acute that the government is plundering its own bank. The government is plundering its own bank. There is an Indian king, a sultan, who plundered his own treasury. There was a king in India who, because of crisis, plundered his own treasury. In the same way, Modi is plundering his own treasury. That is, so this is the extent of Argentina. they plundered. Argentina had a similar situation. It plundered the central bank's reserve. Now India is also plundering its central bank. These are symptoms of crisis. These are symptoms of crisis. Crisis can appear in different manifestations. So that we are experiencing. Okay, I think that you cannot finish this discussion within this. This is a broad subject. We can only raise questions, create more doubts, create more questions. That is what is about. I have no answer with me. I can only share with you my doubts. So we are creating more problems. Okay.
We'll create more problems.
Yes. இந்த கருத்தாடல் இந்த கருத்தரங்கமானது வந்து மிகவும் சிறப்பாக நடைபெற்றது. எங்களுக்கு இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியை ஏற்பாடு செய்த அறிவுச்சுடன் நிறுவனத்தின் சார்பில் கூறிக்கொள்ள நாங்கள் கடமைப்பட்டிருப்பது என்னென்னா, ஒரு சமூகத்தினுடைய செயல்படுத்தக்கூடிய முக்கியமான செயல்படுத்தக்கூடிய சமூகத்தில் போய் செயலாற்றக்கூடிய ஒரு இடம், இது குறித்தான ஒரு விவாதம் நடத்தியிருக்கிறோம். இது ரொம்ப முக்கியமான நேரத்தில் இந்த நேரத்தில் இந்த கருத்தரங்கம் நடத்தியிருக்கிறோம். அதுவும் ஒரு நீண்ட நேரமாக இந்த ஒரு அமைதியான இந்த தோழருடைய உரையை வந்து கேட்டதிலிருந்தும் நீங்கள் உள்வாங்கிக்கிட்ட இந்த விஷயத்திலிருந்தும் எங்களால் புரிஞ்சுக்க முடியுது. இது போன்ற இந்த கருத்தரங்கத்துக்கு வந்து அமைதியான முறையிலையும் எல்லா வகையிலையும் ஒத்துழைப்பு கொடுத்த இந்த கருத்தரங்கத்தினுடைய பார்வையாளர்கள் மிகவும் உன்னதமானவர்கள், மிகவும் மதிக்கத்தக்கவர்கள் இந்த அப்படின்னு எங்களுடைய அறிவு சொல்வதாக சார்பில் மிக பெருமையாக சொல்கிறோம். அதே நேரத்தில் இது போன்ற எல்லா விதமான சூழ்நிலையும் அரசியல் சமூக நிகழ்வுகளிலும் எங்களுடைய அறிவுச்சுடன் நிறுவனத்தின் சார்பில் ஏற்படுத்தப்படும் நிகழ்வுகளில் நீங்கள் எல்லாரும் திரும்ப திரும்ப வந்து கலந்துகணும்னு வேண்டுகோள் விடுத்து எங்களுடைய அறிவுச்சுடன் நிறுவனத்தின் சார்பில் கலந்து கொண்ட அனைவருக்கும் எங்கள் மனமார்ந்த நன்றிகளை உரித்தாக்கி விடைபெறுகிறோம். நன்றி.
Thank you.